This is Taylor Gate at Vassar College in Poughkeepsie, it's upstate New York, not far from Hyde Park. The college was founded in 1861 by a prosperous Poughkeepsie brewer named Matthew Vassar. And I think this is how he described it, founded to be a rich blessing before God to this city and state, to our country, and to the world. And you note the expanding perspective, it was a certain, perhaps even imperialism in this conception of what it would be and how it would spread what it was. I came here in 29, came through these gates in 29, my grandmother and my aunt, and came out in 33. In return for whatever you got here, you did have, I think, much more than in most colleges, the sense that you had to, that you owed it to the world, that you had come out of here with something to contribute, especially, I would say, in the political sphere. And in general, there was a whole tendency of taking Vassar with you into the world, and as the ideas of progress, which had been more or less accepted here, though those two were questioned, became rather universal in the early days of the New Deal, it was as if everybody had become a Vassar girl.
I came out of college in 1933. It was the beginning of the New Deal. Roosevelt had been elected in 32. A whole new world seemed to be opening out of the catastrophe of the Depression. And the Vassar girl, the Vassar mentality was very keyed in to the New Deal, certainly. Our economics professor, Miss Newcomer, I think was always up at Albany, you know, with groups of girls, petitioning or attempting to influence the state legislature. The whole spectrum, as it appears in my book, the group is tinged with this typically Vassar progressive mentality. Vassar was identified with a slightly flamboyant kind of avant-gardism. I remember one popular song about my girls from Vassar, none can surpass her. And there was a Vassar brassiere, and I think there was Vassar underwear. And Vassar was a kind of banner word, and you did picture some young woman carrying some sort of banner.
More than 40 years later, it's 1974. And one has to assume that the Vassar girl in some way has changed since my day. For one thing, Vassar's become coeducational, has black students, that was non-existent in my time. On the question of political involvement, social involvement, I think it's very likely that there has been considerable change. This is another kind of divide in our national life, like the Depression followed by the New Deal. We have had the war in Vietnam, the most tremendous national divide, I think, certainly since the Civil War, followed by Watergate, and then after Watergate, there's bound to be, one trusts, some kind of post-Watergate and not a mere limbo. And the question is, what I wonder is it true that the Vassar student, like all other students of these last few years since the activism of the late 60s, Columbia, Kent State, et cetera, the weathermen, whether Vassar, the Vassar student, has become what they say other students have become at other universities, that is, more conventional, more conformist, I hate the word introspective, and I won't use it, more self-centered, let's say. Whether this is true, whether they've changed in this direction to this extent, and for Vassar, this would be, I think, a very radical break, very radical change.
Well, I think there's a growing feeling that one has to take care of himself or herself, and that this, the type of commitment of giving your life to a particular cause is sometimes very meaningless when you get beneath the surface, and that pursuing a career in which you feel you can be productive and creative and worthwhile is as much of a commitment as joining a mass movement was in 69, perhaps more so.
Still, there is the political arena, and what you will be able to do in your personal life will be maybe greatly affected by that arena.
I think it's only natural that after certain political incidences, there's going to be a feeling that the individual is pretty limited in terms of his or her effect on the political arena as a whole.
A lot of my friends went into, I guess, what you would call counterculture type things, living out in the country and everything, and most of them have discovered that they just can't do it within the present system. That countries where there have been communal type settlements have usually been countries where those kinds of settlements are supported and encouraged by the government and by the whole social system. That, for instance, a few elite college students dropping out is not going to really change anything in this country.
But what is going to change anything? That's my question, really. I talked just recently, a couple of days ago, to a Vassar graduate who'd been here during the protest years, during the, I think she was class of 67 or 68, let's say, the Vietnam protest, and she said that the terrible feeling that they had at that period here in Vassar was this sense of absolute impotency.
I certainly felt it when I first came to Vassar, in the sense that my former environment was, I was in the Army, and the Army during most of the student uprisings and so on, and my general feeling coming back to school was, what had happened? Where had all the activity gone? Where had all the things that I had been reading about and impotent in my own environment, awaiting this chance to be immersed effective in being immersed in sort of social concern in a very activist type of environment, was simply not there, at least not here.
What about Watergate? Did any of you go to the hearings?
I saw the biggies, Ehrlichman, Mitchell, and couple others I can't remember.
I spent the summer in London at the London School of Economics, and we all watched.
I know they had it
three days
a week, I think.
Yes, we watched the hearings, and at that point it was very uncomfortable to be an American abroad. I don't know when it has been comfortable in the last decade to be an American abroad, but at this time there's a great deal of hostility towards American students.
What you say surprises me, because I should have thought that that you'd be rather proud not of you know, Haldeman, Ehrlichman, Nixon, Colson and company, but be rather proud of this democratic process that was going on.
We were proud of the democratic process, but I think what we were suffering was a loss of innocence. Not that we had given such great support to Richard Nixon in the first place, but the feeling that such wide-scale corruption had taken place, and so much silence from so many people could have helped long ago. And there is naturally a feeling of embarrassment when one comes from a country where this has taken place. The possibilities of power and of those in power to corrupt, to behave in a corrupt manner is so great that the only thing one can hope for at this point is
a miracle?
Well, a personal miracle, that that you can at very least lead your own life in accordance with your own standards of equality, justice, whatever ideals.
I agree with this. I've spent most of my life with believing that. But then the moments come when you feel you've got to do something more.
Learning is doing something. I think listening more carefully to the men we elect to office. I think there were warnings long ago about this administration. And the American public closed their ears.
I understand why people voted for Nixon in the sense that they voted against McGovern and many stayed home. It really wasn't all that much of a landslide if you count in the stay-home vote. But I cannot understand how the public could identify itself with Nixon. I simply cannot understand it. I could understand their identifying with LBJ, with Truman, even with Eisenhower in some sort of son or daughter relation to Eisenhower. I cannot see how this, how the people looking at that man on television could identify themselves with him.
I don't think that many people actually did identify themselves with Nixon. I really think it was more of a choice vote, choosing, in fact, against the other candidate.
The 60s, to me, in many ways, represents a time when our great leaders were killed off. The only time I can remember crying in my adult life was when Bobby Kennedy was shot. He represented a really major hero to me. And I think particularly in the Democratic Party, there isn't anybody that I'm really thrilled about. But in some ways, I don't think that it's all that bad. I think America likes to create heroes. We like to create men that don't really exist. Nixon is a classic example of a man that is really just a total representation of what other people would like him to be. And I think it would be good in some ways to be cleansed of this leader worship that Americans have.
I think there's almost another factor in American politics that we haven't mentioned yet. The fact that people have become more afraid of political machines, i.e. business. The fact that business has become so influential in American politics. The fact that the little man no longer has the kind of say that he felt he might have had 10, 15 years ago. And in that sense, it's not only the students, perhaps, but
everybody.
An awful lot of the population has felt impotent.
People are sort of exhausted or from what took place in the late 60s.
You shouldn't be brought up in this society thinking that, you know, you find the greatest hero, as Kim was talking about. That only leads to disappointment.
Those students do seem rather different from the students of my day. It's evident that they felt far less sense of that commitment of a message to carry, a mission to perform to the world, than we aesthetes felt back in 1933.
I'm trying to think when a certain loss of faith in America's ability to govern not only itself, but to produce governing ideas for the world, to lead the world. I'm trying to think when that began to ebb away. I think certainly large parts of the intellectual community had that faith during the Cold War period, and that was partly what the Cold War was about, the whole free world concept. And I think that began to fade out sometime, certainly in the 50s, the late 50s. But I don't know what it was replaced by. I think not much of anything. And until the Vietnam experience began. And then at that point, there seems to me, and I think to most people who watched it or even participated in it, there was some sort of watershed. And I would place it at, say, 65. But that is when we began the bombing in Vietnam and the period of the teach-ins and so on. Other people would say 66 because of the taking the drug culture as the, you know, the dividing line. But in any case, around 65, 66, there was a watershed, and you got the revulsion against our leadership, against all our leadership. It seems so evident that Vietnam changed everything, and I think that the country has not recovered from Vietnam and will not recover until in some way it comes to terms with it. It certainly won't recover while the war's going on, though, as they said, the color of the corpses has been changed. Somebody suggested to me, a Frenchman, as a matter of fact, that Watergate and the public's attitude toward Watergate, its zeal in the pursuit of truth, which ended in the pursuit of Nixon, that is, the attempt to force the truth out of Nixon and his associates, that this whole thing was an attempt on the part of the American people to become clean, to get clean, to be purged of the guilt that they felt, whether they admitted it or not, for the war in Vietnam. This burden of guilt on a people that imagined itself superior, morally superior, entitled to world leadership, that's what we were supposedly doing in Vietnam, was leading the free world, that this guilt was very hard to shoulder. And suddenly the Watergate offered the possibility of, as I say, a cleansing. I think for most Americans that the Watergate thing has been both depressing and exhilarating, because I think any pursuit that seems to be ending successfully, this pursuit of truth is exhilarating. And that there was, especially last summer in Washington, I was covering Watergate hearings, the Senate, the Urban Committee hearings for the Observer in London. And there was a marvelous sense in those audiences, in the public, that crowded hall, and even among people who watched it on television, a sense that there was some possibility here of the country being not only purged, but the country could be reborn. And a figure like Senator Urban, who was a deeply conservative man, seemed to indicate that it would be possible to retrieve some of the old American values that are embodied in the Constitution. You felt that there's some possibility of what had been good in this country and what perhaps was still good in this country and its power to receive all this bad news, to face up to it, and even in some way be exhilarated by the process of the pursuit of truth. You thought this could lead to something new. Certainly, the biggest shock, surprise, so on, was the tapes, the revelation that Nixon had been taping not only his associates and heads of state, foreign states, and so on, but that he'd actually been taping himself for this whole period, is something I don't think anybody has yet understood or got over. And it seems the tapes have been absolutely crucial. They were the tapes became a catalyzer, and that everything that one knew about Nixon, that is, his it revealed this extraordinary passion for control, secrecy, monitoring the environment of these let's say semi-totalitarian traits, but it also the battle of the tapes revealed the traits in his character that may have been known to a minority, certainly known to his opponents. But the whole business of double dealing, concealment, lying, etc. Once the tapes, once we knew that those tapes existed, it was obvious that they were going to be tampered with. However, it took a number of months before this fact came out, because as long as Nixon held on to the tapes, it was not nobody knew whether they'd been tampered with or not. And probably there will be revelations about the tape for a long time to come. Other things came out more about his private psychology, his private persona, such as that he used filthy language. And this I think has been one of his main reasons for not wanting the tapes out. Quite aside from what he has to conceal politically, what guilt he has to conceal, there's this. I mean, nobody would have been shocked if Johnson had been taping himself, and it turned out that he used a great many four-letter words and extremely coarse, abusive language, because that was part of Johnson's public image. But Nixon's public image, is mealy-mouthed, decent, his Quaker mother, and so on. And to find that this man was absolutely split in two, and it's all recorded on the tapes, this, I think, has been fascinating. They have been a catalyzer. They brought everything out. But what will be the sequel to Watergate? What can it be? This may have been simply a very heroic rear-guard action. The defense, to monitor the defense of the Constitution against Nixon and his group. It had been merely, perhaps it was merely that, a gallant stand, but historically it may be almost meaningless, an anecdote of history. What was interesting about the demeanor of some of the witnesses before the Irvin Committee, particularly Ehrlichman's cocksure and arrogant, bullying, insulting demeanor, it's very clear that these men, Nixon's men, particularly Haldeman and Ehrlichman, exemplified it, really had believed and still believed right there. They weren't yet under indictment, but they soon would be, and they knew it. They thought they were the future, and that somebody like Senator Talmadge, the old Georgian, another old conservative, when Senator Talmadge talked about the right of privacy, he was referring to the Ellsberg psychiatrist burglary, and said, "Down where I come from, there's an old saying, we got it from England, that a man's house is his castle, and even the king can't come in there without a search warrant, etc." Ehrlichman just smiled at him patronizingly, and he said, "That belief's been a little bit eroded, hasn't it, Senator? This confidence." I have the terrible feeling that Ehrlichman may be right, and that whether he himself survives politically or whether he's ruined, disbarred, perhaps isn't so important, that some other Ehrlichmans and Haldemans are waiting in the wings for us, perhaps less declared, less flamboyant, more muted personalities. And it seems to me that this is very possibly our future, because I don't see what we've got to substitute, really, for the Nixon gang, except, say, the Ford gang, the Gerald Ford gang, who are a little bit cleaner, who are not, probably don't have nakedly, they're not energetic enough even perhaps to have nakedly authoritarian or semi-totalitarian ambitions. But it'll amount to the same. You begin to think about the next presidential elections in 76. And we're right back where we were before Watergate, that is, with practically no choice. No new political figures have been thrown up on the national scene, I think, anyway, by Watergate, any more than they were by the opposition to the war in Vietnam. It seems to me that the last time there was really any hope for something new and possible in American politics was in the Eugene McCarthy's campaign for the nomination in 66, McCarthy's Children's Crusade, and it failed. Nixon has simply ruled youth out, ruled youth as a mass out of his calculations, as if youth did not exist.
Goes beyond these particular students, obviously, that their situation that sense of choicelessness and that sense of embarrassment. They felt embarrassed at being Americans before the world. All that is, I think, almost universal in the at least conscious parts of the American population. And these students merely embodied it. It seems sadder with them because they're young. That somehow to be choiceless and young is worse than to be, looks worse than to be choiceless and middle-aged. And yet there it is. And there aren't any immediate, the field of choice is very narrow. It has been for 10 or 15 years at least. But the whole post-Watergate business, I think Watergate has given this country some kind of opportunity. And the problem is whether anybody in this country, young, middle-aged, or old, the old perhaps are the most qualified, but in any case, whether anybody in this country will know how to pick up this opportunity and use it.